My BJJ, do you find that there is a correlation between lowering of LDL and lowering of inflammation with statins? Yes. So for the people that have FH, I mean, familial hypercholesterolemia, which there are about 2,000 SNPs. For those of you who don't know what a SNP is, most of it think of it as a mutation. It's not technically a mutation, but it's a genetic variation. There's about 2,000 genetic variations that have been defined so far that cause FH, extremely high cholesterol levels. For example, that's LDL, not total cholesterol, LDL 180 or above. If you've ever had that, you're very likely to have familial hypercholesterolemia. And there's a lot of you out there. As you get into those levels and higher, you do get some challenges associated with this issue. But as I mentioned earlier, not nearly as much as what the typical medical community member thinks. So the second part of your question, is this the reason why statins lower inflammation? No. So a great question, BJJ. Is the decreased cardiovascular inflammation associated with decreased LDL? It certainly does not appear to be the case. And I'll give you a couple of reasons and examples why. One of the more effective ones, statins at lowering LDL, is that old standard, Lipitor. And I mentioned the brand name, so the YouTube algorithm's gonna cut us off for advertisements on this, but it's worth it. Lipitor is great in terms of lowering LDL, but it's not so good in terms of decreasing inflammation. So that in and of itself helps you understand that these are two different mechanisms. The mechanism for decreasing that inflammation is not entirely understood. But one thing that is understood is it does not seem to correlate that well with lowering LDL. You go back to the Jupiter study, you go back to multiple studies, you go back to the example I just gave, and you know, you look at some others. Here's another example. Low doses of the correct statins lower inflammation and may not have that much of an impact on LDL levels. For example, people that are on statins will typically come to me. One of the patients yesterday had stopped taking statins. His doctor had put him on 20 of Lipitor, 20 or 40. I mean, it was a significant dosage. And he didn't like it. He was having a lot of muscle problems, so he stopped it. He'd been off it for quite a few months before he came to see me. Here was an interesting thing that we looked at. He had no inflammation. His LDL was, what, 130, 140? It was more than what most doctors would be comfortable with. But here was the thing. His CIMT showed an arterial age of, what, 35? And this individual was 61 years old. Superman, in terms of arteries. And he had no discrete plaque. He had no plaque. So, you know, he and I talked, and he said, one of the reasons I came to see you was, I know your perspective on this stuff. My doc kept trying to put me on a statin. I'm getting in a lot of pain from these. I don't want it. And I'm wanting to know from you, do you think I need one? Well, I mean, most of you know my perspective. I don't think that just an LDL level is that dangerous and B, the reason to put somebody on a statin. I don't think Framingham is the reason to put somebody on a statin, and I don't use stress tests. What I look at is whether you have plaque, because if you don't have plaque, you're not going to have a heart attack, at least the kind that we're talking about. You can have some dysrhythmias and some totally different things that sometimes get called heart attack, but you're not going to have what we're talking about with myocardial infarction or a heart attack associated with a clot. You're not going to have one if you have no plaque. So my perspective was, if I were you and I had the total lack of inflammation that you have, if I have the total lack of plaque that you have, I wouldn't take it. You don't need it right now. So again, as usual, I went down a whole bunch of bunny holes. I hope that answered your question. There is little to no correlation between lowering LDL and lowering cardiovascular inflammation. Why wait for a disease and hope for a cure? I used to be an ER doc. My name is Ford Brewer. I quit ER after a few years because it was just so frustrating. Most of the things bringing people into the ER are things that should have been prevented, including heart attack, stroke, number one cause of death, number one cause of permanent disability. People think that you're just going to have those and that they're not predictable. Both of those are wrong. they are predictable and you don't have to have them. Usually it's lifestyle. Lifestyle is more important than supplements and even prescription drugs and even stents and surgery. But the current times are tough. Major financial impact with the lockdowns that most states have been going through. We've been working on a way to make this much more affordable with a subscription process. And that's exactly what we're announcing today. We've got two levels. One is the Silver membership, where you get access to our courses, a private webinar each month, and access to our supplement store and supplement recommendations and prescription. Or I would suggest even more so, the Gold membership. You can get a script for a freestyle Libre and find out what your blood sugar metabolism's doing on a daily basis. And you can get a lab order for inflammation, OGTT, and insulin survey. You can also get a 30-minute one-on-one with me. So I'm looking forward to seeing you. Cost is no longer an excuse. So if you're interested, go to go.prevmedheartrest.com/prevmed-subscription or call us at 859-721-1414, 859-721-1414, or email us at myhealth@prevmedheartrisk.com. Looking forward to seeing you. Thank you.